Lord God Almighty. Lord God Almighty, reign. Alleluia, holy, holy, are you Lord God Almighty? Worthy is the Lamb. Worthy is the Lamb, you are holy, holy, are you Lord God Almighty? Worthy is the Lamb, worthy is the Lamb, amen, hallelujah. For the Lord God Almighty reigns. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. For the Lord God Almighty.
It's our privilege just to welcome you this morning to the celebration of life of Klaus. And that's truly what it is. As Christians, we believe that Klaus is in a better place. We have faith and we have hope that he's with his Heavenly Father. And we celebrate today. We come and celebrate a good man who had a good life, who had people around him who loved him and cared for him. And we celebrate that we got to be part of his life, to experience just being in his presence and knowing him. I've had the privilege of being Klaus's pastor for the last 5 years, and Klaus was a big part of Cheers. We always joked around because him and Marnie were the elders of our church as a young church, and so we always got to tease him about being one of the old people. And he was a big believer in us and the work of Cheers. He was a steady hand and a calm voice. He was a gentle and good man, and he's going to be missed. Father, we just thank you this morning for your love. Above all things, God, we just thank you that you love us, God. Everyone here, Lord, you love them. They're all your kids, Lord. We're all your children. And Father, I thank you that Klaus is with you this day, God. I thank you for that faith and that hope that we have, Lord, that he is with you in a better place, God. And that we can come and be together to mourn and to celebrate, to rejoice, to comfort. And I just pray, Father, especially for Marnie and the kids, Lord, that you would just touch each one of them in a special way as they come and say goodbye. Lord, goodbye but not forgotten. So, Lord, just let your presence be felt in this place. In your name we pray. Amen. You may be seated. Thank you.
all I seek. And when your eyes are on this child, your grace abounds to me. Your grace abounds to me.
The songs this morning are all special songs that were special to Klaus, and so we just celebrate and we just take time to reflect on the words of these songs as they meant a lot to him. As well, we just want to give a special welcome to all Klaus's family that are watching live streaming in Germany and across Canada, and just our prayers and thoughts are with them as well. At this time, we're going to have Chris Dopp come and read a scripture. And they'll be followed by Rolf Rybak to share a memory.
There is a time for everything, and everything on earth has a special season. There is a time to be born and a time to die. There is a time to plant and a time to pull up plants. There is a time to kill and a time to heal. There is a time to destroy and a time to build. There is a time to cry and a time to laugh. There's a time to be sad, and there is a time to dance. There's a time to throw away stones and a time to gather them. There is a time to hug and a time not to hug. There's a time to look for something and a time to stop looking for it. There's a time to keep things and a time to throw things away. There's a time to tear apart, and there is a time to sew together. There's a time to be silent, and a time to speak. There's a time to love, and a time to hate. There's a time for war, and a time for peace.
Thank you all for being here today. Klaus was my brother. I'd like to take a few moments to speak for the extended family that couldn't be here today. They're scattered around the globe, but always remain family. And I'd like to read some of the words of remembrance they would like to share with you today. First of all, from my cousin Ursula Ross Meyer in Ohio. Cousin Ursula Ross Meyer says, "I enjoy talking to Klaus. It felt like coming home, like family. His father, Bruno, and my mother, Crystal, were brother and sister, close in age and spirit. My father, Heinz, and his father were best friends. His mother, Hilda, and mine were dear friends. These two young couples who spent their adolescence in war and chaos first moved from the home in the Black Forest of Germany, then across the world to Canada and the United States. They moved to a new culture, a new language, a new life, with nothing but hopes, their dreams, and their faith, and their ability to make a better life for the children. They hoped that the move would spare the children, their children's children, the suffering the families had endured through World Wars I and II. And it has. That relative peaceful life that Klaus and I enjoyed was hard fought by our parents. And that's what Klaus and I talked about. We shared our experiences of growing up immigrants in a strange land. We analyzed our crazy parents and their struggles with the past and their new lives. We noted the physical and psychological quirks we had in common. And Ursula says, "Can you kids roll your R's?" Klaus had the father's endurance and his mother's sympathy. Klaus and I filled the spaces of our shared biology and our shared history. I will miss him. I know in my heart our Oma Ida has her high-spirited son Bruno by her side, and they're both welcoming Klaus with open arms. Thank you, Ursula. And from my Aunt Crystal Ross, "When I think of Klaus, I see the young man when I visited North Vancouver with his aunt Hilla and cousin Tanya from Germany. He obviously adored his one-year-old baby girl, Laura, and his face shone with pleasure as he cuddled her. Klaus spoke with pride of his two sons, David and Neil, as they packed up their hockey practice. I remember the happiness and contentment I saw in his face as he spoke of his children and their escapades. His father and mother loved these grandchildren. They appreciated and were proud of Klaus's efforts to be a good father. We talked about this loving young family all the way back to Vancouver. The next time I saw Laura, she was a beautiful young woman who reminded me so much of her grandmother, my dear friend Hilda. It was so wonderful to see Klaus, Laura, and Marnie at my grandson's 2010 wedding in Denver. Klaus talked about his now grown sons with a father's immodesty. Klaus was very proud of his athletic son Neil, the marathon runner, and delighted with his son, David, who was an independent young man building a solid life on his own. Klaus had been through very difficult passages, and I was glad to see him in good health and good spirits. In this, Klaus was just like his mother, Hilda. She was always able to be at peace in the midst of most difficult challenges, no matter the outcome. It is my prayer that his mother was there to welcome him with open arms as he left us. Thank you, Crystal." And from our cousin, Erwin Ross in Denver, Colorado, "When I think of Klaus, I think of our families, the Rybaks and the Rosses. My mother, Crystal, and Klaus's father, Bruno, were brothers and sisters. The Rybaks and the Ross were indicative of a generation of post-World War II immigrants that came to America for a better life. Our parents sacrificed so their children could grow up in America and all the opportunities they represented. I am the recipient of my parents' sacrifice, as was Klaus. Klaus and I were both born the eldest sons of immigrant fathers, and with that came many expectations, but our parents were also great teachers. Our parents taught us the value of hard work and the importance of family. They also taught us dignity and the importance of respect." He fast forwards 50 years. The Rybaks lived in Canada and the Rosses lived in the United States. Early on, travel was difficult and even telephone calls were expensive. Neither family were well off. Time and distance are the enemies of many relationships. Our parents stayed bonded, but the children's generation had difficulties connecting. 3 years ago, my oldest son, my youngest son was getting married, and my wife and I took a chance and invited Klaus and Marnie to the wedding. And they said yes. This time, the courage was from Klaus. Denver, Colorado was over 1,000 miles away. Klaus came to visit a cousin he had never seen before. 50 years, wow, am I glad he said yes. Klaus had no idea what he was walking into. A few days before the wedding, Klaus and Marnie arrived. I remember Klaus walking towards me and thinking, yeah, he's my cousin. It's amazing how genetics work. Here's a guy my size, my build, and every bit of Rybak. But Klaus is not one mold. The cousin I met was warm and welcoming. 50 years of separation had disappeared in an instant. Klaus, like our fathers, was a man of strength and dignity. As most of you know, Klaus's strength was not always in body, but always in spirit. He gave when many people take. He knew humility, and he gave back selfishly. Klaus, you are the eldest son of an immigrant father. There were many expectations. Your father and your heavenly father are proud. You did good, Klaus. You will be greatly missed. Thank you for taking a chance to meet a long-separated cousin. Our prayers follow you. May God hold you in the palm of his hands. And thank you, Erwin, for that. And now, again, a few words from me. Again, I'd like to thank you for all being here today. Klaus was my older brother, a year and a half older. We were often mistaken as twins and became inseparable as childhood. Our childhood friends would tell their parents they were going out to play or meet Klaus and Rolf. It wasn't until quite a while later when their parents saw both of us together, they realized there was actually two of us. Not one kid with a strange German name of Klaus and Rolf. As young adults, we shared friends and activities, and I married my beautiful wife, Deborah. She welcomed him to our immediate family with no hesitation. She always set a third plate at the dinner table, and looking back, I'm still amazed how large those plates were. To this day, our mutual friends will repeat stories in awe about our ferocious appetites. 5 pounds of bacon on Saturday morning breakfast. As a young man, he loved the outdoors, the mountains, and testing himself on the cliffs in Squamish. As soon as he learned to rock climb, he introduced me to the sport and his new circle of friends. We formed a special bond, sharing a rope for years while pushing the limits of our courage and skill. There we were, young Turks, eager to leave our mark, impatient for change, and importantly, we earned the respect of our peers. Our bond as brothers deepened, but we still argued about who was the best athlete. And Klaus, if you're listening, no, you're wrong, it was me. I now think the life lessons Klaus learned in the outdoors helped him cope with the adversities he faced later in his life and gave him the courage and strength to step up and face his many trials. That door of our life closed, we grew apart, but other doors opened for Klaus. Other people shared the good times and the bad times with him, became partners in his life. After both our parents passed away a few years ago, we reconnected. Seasons changed, but we were still brothers, and maybe that's the way it was supposed to be. I can still see Klaus as a young man. Radio at his side, listening to one of his favorite tunes. In the future, when you hear this tune, it'll play in a moment. I hope you think of Klaus, a loving husband, a father, a friend, and my dear brother.
At this time, we're just going to have Marnie come.
Thank you, Joey. I am Klaus's wife, and a lot of people that know me know I've got this thing for dragonflies. And I said, you know, one day I'm going to share with some of my friends at work and just people. I just know I just collect dragonflies. I didn't think it'd be under these circumstances, but I'd like to read to you something that's in the brochure that they handed out at the door. It's called The Dragonfly. Cecil B. DeMille, the renowned movie director of world fame, was also a man of Christian faith. It was he who dramatically depicted the Bible stories on the screen. I'm sure that most of us have seen his motion picture, The Ten Commandments. Shortly before his death, he wrote the following. One day, as I was lying in a canoe, a big black beetle came out of the water and climbed into the canoe. I watched it idly for some time. Under the heat of the sun, the beetle proceeded to die. Then a strange thing happened. His glistening back shell cracked all the way down his back. Out of it came a shapeless mass, quickly transformed into a beautiful, brilliantly colored life. As I watched in fascination, there gradually unfolded iridescent wings from which the sunlight flashed 1,000 colors. The wings spread wide as if in worship of the sun. The blue-green body took shape. Before my eyes had occurred a metamorphosis, the transformation of a hideous beetle into a gorgeous dragonfly, which started dipping and soaring all over the water. But the body it had left behind still clung to my canoe. I had witnessed what seemed to me a miracle. Out of the mud had come a beautiful new life. The thought came to me, continued DeMille, that if the Creator works such wonders with the lowliest of creatures, what may not be in store for the human spirit?
Thank you, Marnie. Your courage and poise is a testament to all of us, and we just bless you. At this point, Nora's going to come, Nora Balvely, and share a verse, and then followed by Pastor Dennis.
Sure. A little bit nervous. When the Son of Man comes in his glory, his majesty and splendor, and all the holy angels with him, and then he will sit on the throne of his glory. All nations will be gathered before him, and he will separate them, the people from one another, as a shepherd separates his sheep from the goats. And he will cause the sheep to stand at his right hand, and the goats at his left. Then the king will say to those at his right hand, come, you blessed of my Father, you favored of God and appointed to eternal salvation. Inherit, receive as your own the kingdom prepared for you from the foundations of the world. For I was hungry, and you gave me food. I was thirsty, and you gave me something to drink. I was a stranger, and you brought me together with yourself and welcomed and entertained and lodged me. I was naked, and you clothed me. I was sick, and you visited me with help and ministering care. I was in prison, and you came to see me. Then the just and upright will answer him, Lord, when did we see you hungry and gave you food, or thirsty and gave you something to drink? And when did we see you a stranger and welcome and entertained you, or naked and clothed you? And when did we see you sick or in prison and came to visit you? And the king will reply to them, truly I tell you, insofar as you did it for one of the least in the estimation of men, of these my brethren, you did it for me.
Good morning. I'm Dennis. I'm one of Klaus's pastors. I knew Klaus for about 6 years. For five and a half years, I was his pastor. And in that time, we went from that relationship just to being friends. And so it's a difficult thing we do here today. We say goodbye to somebody that we love and we cherish. For us here at the church, Klaus came early on, almost at the very beginning. It took a little cajoling to get him there because he said, we're too old to come to your church. And he wasn't joking. They really thought that they wouldn't be welcome because they were too old. But we all know Klaus. And he was quite young at heart. I think of all the crazy stories I hear about picking people up at the airport dressed as a Hare Krishna. We took the kids there trick-or-treating to his house once, and we saw Dog the Bounty Hunter. We had always planned when we brought a guest speaker into the church one day to send Marnie and Klaus in a costume to pick up the speaker and freak him out, but we never got around to that. I was struck by the words of his cousin who hadn't met him in over 50 years and how instantly those years faded away. Because that so rightly describes my experience with Klaus. We were separated by a few years, but it just seemed that we could get together and we could do work bees here at the church. Klaus and I spent many hours just painting, and even though his body was failing him, he just continued to give, and I would have to stay close. It's time to take a break. Oh, I think we can do a few more things. Just the way he was. We both suffered through the Canucks' devastating Stanley Cup loss a couple of years ago, and it was quite heartbreaking for Klaus, as it was for all of us. We just did those kind of things together, and generally, you know, I'm 40, and he was in his 60s. It just seems like he shouldn't be that close, but those years melted away, and we became friends. I work very closely with Klaus's wife, Marnie. We pretty much talk to each other 3 or 4 times a week in our jobs. And oftentimes she would say to me, well, we're reading through the Bible to this year from cover to cover, and I'm beating Klaus. I'm ahead of Klaus. And they were trying to race to see who could get to the end first. And they did that, and Klaus did that, because he believed in that book. He believed it wasn't just a story. He believed it was the words of God. He believed it was worth his time, and it brought him comfort, and it brought him strength. And so as his friend and his pastor, to do him honor, I felt it appropriate to comb through the scriptures and find something that I could hold before you as a picture of Klaus's life. I believe when Klaus read the scriptures that I'm about to share with you, it was like looking into a mirror. The scriptures I came up with were found in 1 John chapter 4, verse 7, and they're on the screen. I'm just going to read it briefly. It says, "Dear friends, let us continue to love one another, for love comes from God. Anyone who loves is a child of God and knows God. But anyone who does not love does not know God, for God is love. God showed how much he loved us by sending his one and only Son into the world so that we might have eternal life through him. This is real love. Not that we love God, but that he loved us and sent his Son as a sacrifice to take away our sins. Dear friends, since God loved us that much, we surely ought to love each other. No one has ever seen God, but if we love each other, God lives in us, and his love is brought to full expression in us. And God has given us his Spirit as proof that we live in him and he in us. Furthermore, we have seen with our own eyes and now testify that the Father has sent his Son to be the Savior of the world. All who confess that Jesus is the Son of God have God living in them, and they live in God. How much more? We know how much God loves us, and we can put our trust in his love. God is love, and all who live in love live in God, and God lives in them. As we live in God, our love grows more perfect, so we will not be afraid on the day of judgment, but we can face him with confidence because we live like Jesus in this world. Over the last 5 years, I've spent many conversations with Klaus, and this, in a nutshell, is what Klaus believed. Verse 15 says, if we confess that Jesus is the Son of God, they have God living in him. And at the back of the church here this morning, you will see Klaus's baptismal certificate. Years ago, he made a public profession of his faith. I believe in Jesus. God is love, and all who live in love, and God lives in them. It says on that day, we won't have to be afraid because we have confidence. Klaus has confidence. He had confidence standing before his Father. Right? Over the last 5 years, in this journey of this church, which Klaus has laid a foundation, he was a part of the foundation of this church. He was constantly cheering us on. He was constantly bringing advice that we asked for, we sought. I had many meetings with Klaus where he dreamed about what would happen here one day. It was a big part of his life. I shared a story once in church. And Klaus came to me and he talked to me about it afterwards. And he said, that story has changed the way I think about God. About 8 years ago, I welcomed my daughter into the world. I remember that moment so clearly because the nurse came and she put my little daughter Faith into my arms. And she said, Daddy, why don't you take your daughter and walk around and introduce yourself? So I took little Faith and I walked her through the halls of the hospital. I began to speak to my daughter. And obviously, she couldn't understand. But I spoke words of love. I spoke words of comfort. I said, Daddy will always protect you, Faith. Daddy will always love you. Daddy will always be there for you. The Bible says, even though your earthly father isn't perfect, he knows how to love. How much more your Heavenly Father? And Klaus, over the last few years, began to see his Heavenly Father the way he saw that story. The way, if you're a parent here this morning, it's the way you felt when you held your firstborn in your arms for the first time. Peter, you understand that feeling. It's a supernatural feeling. It's a supernatural love when you welcome a child into your arms and you've never met them before, but for 9 months they've made your wife miserable. For 9 months they've made your wife grumpy. And the moment they come out, it's kicking and screaming, you're in love with that child. And Klaus began to understand that's the way the Father felt about him. And it transformed the way he felt about himself. Because Klaus wasn't a perfect man. He'd be the first person to admit that he was imperfect. He'd be the first person to admit that he had imperfections and flaws. But he wasn't standing before God saying, I was perfect. He was standing before God and saying, I receive you, Father. So we can have confidence. He had joy. He had peace. Klaus was often ill physically. Marnie would say, Marnie, how's Klaus doing? And she'd say, oh, Klaus is not doing well. He's struggling. And then I would go to Klaus and say, hey, Klaus, how you doing? Oh, I'm doing fine. I'm doing great. But I knew he was ill. And about 3 weeks ago, we had a prayer meeting here at the church. Klaus was always attending those. I said, Klaus, I just felt in my heart that I wanted to go pray for Klaus and pray a blessing over him. That God would just touch his body, make him feel better. And so I grabbed a couple of guys from the church and we surrounded Klaus. I said, Klaus, I want to pray for you that God will touch your body, play a blessing over you. And he said, no, don't pray for me, but pray for those who don't know Jesus that way. He said, pray for those who don't know him as their Heavenly Father. That's what I want for my friends. And that's just the way Klaus was. You offer him a blessing, and he says, the greatest blessing is that my friends and my family will know the love of God. The Bible says that we do grieve, but we don't grieve without hope. So we call this a celebration of life this morning because Klaus lived a life worth celebrating. We celebrate that Klaus didn't know a God who was angry at him. We celebrate the fact that Klaus didn't fear God in a way that he was going to be punished for every mistake. We celebrate that Klaus knew a heavenly father that just wanted to wrap his arms around Klaus and say, Daddy loves you. We celebrate today because we know Klaus is experiencing that this moment. He's in the arms of his father. And there's a gaping hole in our hearts. But we have a peace and a confidence knowing that Daddy's there. I just want to pray this morning. Father, in these times when we grieve, and it just seems that words fail us, God, we pray the prayer that Klaus asked us to pray, Lord, that you would just show your love and your grace and your mercy to his family and his friends. Lord, that your spirit would come and just be a comfort in this time. Lord, we just thank you that we have a confidence knowing that Klaus is with you and we will celebrate with him again one day. In Jesus' name.
Amen. At this time, we're just going to invite you to come, and if anyone has something they'd like to share, we're just going to have an open mic and allow you to share a quick story or thought about Klaus. And so if there'd be anyone who'd like to share, you just make your way up front here. Otherwise, I'll have to sing a song or something, and that'll just be awkward for everyone.
This is Klaus's best friend and the best man from our wedding, Holger Gruenberg. He asked me to hold the mic.
Hi, folks. It's been a long time since I've spoken in front of a large audience, but for Klaus, I'll do it. I just have a few words in German. Zu die Verwandten in Deutschland, herzlichen Beileid. That means, to the relatives in Germany, heartfelt sympathy. This clipboard here represents all the fun we had blowing up balloons for the lists of celebrations of the day in Marnie and Klaus's store. Scary, yeah. My name is Holger, affectionately known as Hog to the family. I'm wearing pink to represent Klaus's warm heart. Laura, the apple of his eye. Neil, his star distance runner. David, his university graduate. Andrew and Petra make his most favorite French fries. Peter and Ange for the second granddaughter, Susan and Horst for the first granddaughter. His friendship and love was genuine. Each of us has a special memory of Klaus, whether happy or sad. I know he would want us to cherish the good times. Whether it was building shelves for the new celebration store or admiring hot rods on Lake Chelan's Main Street, it was always fun times with Klaus. Klaus was like a kid with a new toy when he got his new red ragtop Beamer. He says, "Want to go for a ride?" I said, "Sure." So off we went, wind on our face and through our hair. There's something about that feeling that rebuilds the soul. On our return back to the home, we went up a steep uphill grade that had a right angle turn at the top. I believe it was Sinclair Road in Summerland. I thought, slow down. Instead, Klaus kicks it down a gear and puts his foot into it. He scared the crap out of me. The little car was on rails and we were safely around the turn. I looked at him and saw his fiendish grin, which turned into a smile when he looked at me. I nodded with appreciation and approval. Nice car. And now, Klaus, you're riding in God's chariot on the heaven's highway paved in gold, scaring the angels.
Good morning. My name is Sandy Foreman. I'm from Summerland. And when my husband and I walked in, he said, I think I'm the only bald man in here. Anyways, I've been blessed with very good health, and I was able to donate a kidney to a friend. So we became friends with Marty and Klaus a couple of years ago. Anyways, I would like to read you a poem that was written quite a long time ago. And it just confirms my belief that we all should think about our life, and it's called The Dash. You may have heard it before, and it's written by Linda Ellis. I read of a person who stood to speak at the funeral of a friend. He referred to the dates on his tombstone from the beginning to the end. He noted that first came the date of his birth and spoke of the following date with tears. But he said what mattered most of all was that dash between those years. For that dash represented all the time that he spent alive on earth. And now only those who loved him know what that little line was worth. For it not matters not how much we own, the cars, the house, the cash. What matters is how we live and love and how we spend our dash. So think about this long and hard. Are there things that you'd like to change? For you never know how much time is left that can still be rearranged. If we could just slow down enough to consider what's true and real, and always try to understand how other people feel, and be less quick to anger, and show appreciation more, and love the people in our lives like we've never loved before. If we treat each other with respect, and more often wear a smile, remembering that this special dash might only last a little while. So when your eulogy is being read, with your life's actions to rehash, would you be proud of the things they say about how you spent your dash?
Hello. My name is Darcy Godfrey, and when my husband and I moved to Penticton, I remember walking through the mall with Dennis and running into Peter, which was a lovely day, because he said, oh, you're looking for a place. My mom and her husband have a basement suite, and they're just getting it ready and looking for someone to move in. And I was like, well, I was 9 months pregnant, honestly, it was huge. I said, I don't know if they're gonna be okay with this, and he's like, oh, you don't know them yet. So truly, we moved in and had a beautiful baby boy who was loved and admired by Klaus and Marnie, and that was the beginning of a wonderful journey. That's not the story I want to share. The story that I want to share is for you, of course, and for Klaus's family in Germany, because there's some things that some people might not know. Going downtown Penticton, and Nell and I were meeting some of our some of the guys on the street who live in various places amongst homelessness in our community. And I ran into Gator one day, and we were just talking about Klaus and Marnie, and he was saying, he's like, they're such good people. On Christmas Eve, they came and picked me up in the middle of the night, and they brought me to my brother's place, and I was cold, and you know, I got to spend the night, And there's a whole wonderful community that live mostly downtown and in various areas. And Klaus loved them and honored them and would move them and find them and take care of them the best that he could. And so when Dennis was reading those verses about love, it truly, truly is Klaus. And he was in the midst of starting, well, he started a society that's up and going, and he's looking to support people who need some extra support and possibly chronic homelessness and chronic addiction and a home and a place for them to feel warm at minus nine and to be taken care of. And so it's so nice to walk down the street and just know that Klaus's legacy amongst all of us is such love and compassion. So when you're downtown today or tomorrow, and there's some guys and they're hanging out, smile and say hello. Because it's, you know, it's what we can do. It's in honor of Klaus.
I think you've already had your time.
Well, the first was a story off the internet, and this one is totally from my heart. When I started working with homeless people 5 years ago, I didn't know what path it was going to take me, and I just believe that the Lord wanted Klaus and I to help them, because if you're not clean and sober, you can't stay in for 48 hours. You can't stay in the local shelter. So we did start reading the Bible again, January 1st, and there was different stories in there that were speaking to me about God testing us. And we had a good group. Actually, 2 years ago, we started working on the homeless shelter. Iman and I did, and Iman Godet. And we started filling out the forms, and they just looked like a two-year-old. We didn't know what to put down. They're pretty tricky. They're very hard. So we brought all the forms home, and I said to Klaus, this is what Iman and I did. It took us 2 hours at Tim Hortons. It doesn't make any sense. So Klaus signed up for a course, and he took a course, and he got 100 in every lesson, and it was how to start a nonprofit organization. So we started the ball rolling last September, and Klaus was doing all the paperwork, and we were waiting for the government to finally give us approval. And I felt that the Lord was speaking to me while I was reading the Bible, just different things, how people are tested, you know, in the Old Testament, wandering around for 40 years in the desert. And I'm like, we're going to do this shelter. No matter what, we're going to have this shelter. And I really felt that God was going to have some, allow some hurdles. And I was thinking maybe neighbors saying not in my neighborhood, or maybe city council saying, I'm sorry, that's not zoned properly. And I never dreamed in a million years that I would be facing this huge hurdle of trying to establish a homeless shelter without Klaus. I never got that message from God. I just knew there'd be hurdles, but anyway, I just want to go forward and in Klaus's memory. And I believe we will have a shelter, because I believe it's God's plan. And it was in Klaus's heart to help people. He was game for anything. He knew a lot of people. After 5 years, we're walking around downtown, and you know, I say, oh, this is my friend so and so, and you know, I don't say exactly how I know them, but you can kind of tell that maybe they don't have a house to live in. And so the fact that they knew them let me off the hook, right, Nada? There's a confidentiality thing at the welfare office, so I can't give out any names, and I can't tell Klaus who I'm working with, but a lot of the people became friends, and some of them came to church. So I could phone Klaus at home and say, hey, so-and-so needs a coat, or so-and-so needs to be driven to rehab, or, You know, one time Klaus picked a guy up at the hospital. They had our name down for next of kin, and he brought him home, and he knew him, and he had a shower, and Klaus gave him his clothes. And then Klaus made him breakfast, and then he drove him to Kelowna to his mother's place. He was a younger guy. He was in his early 30s. So, you know, it was truly, he was truly on board with all of this. He loved everybody equally. He especially had a heart for those less fortunate than us. And I believe that I know that he's going to be with us as we go forward and get this shelter. It's going to be living through him. And I just want to add one thing, that a week ago, right now, like as we speak, wow, it's getting late. We were downtown at the farmer's market, walking around together, I mean, 1 week ago. And we'd been camping overnight, just one night at Vassal Lake. And we woke up in the morning, came home, had a shower, went to the farmer's market, went out for lunch at Celebrations, our old balloon store that's now a Greek restaurant, came home, had a nap, went out on the KVR, and, you know, we rode our bikes to OK Falls, and then on the way back, he just passed away like that. But we had a wonderful weekend, and I really believe that God was with him. Klaus did not want to go hooked up to machines. And, you know, he was here 1 minute and gone the next. And I turned around and I'm like, where is he? And so I go back to the crest of the hill and he was at the side. And they worked on him. But, you know, I believe that I know his prayer was not to be, you know, some kind of a vegetable and whatever. And it was a true blessing. The way he went, he would have gone that way. And I just feel so thankful that God brought Klaus into my life, into our lives, whatever way that looks like. And I believe that Klaus will live on for a long, long time when we get this shelter going and then some. So thank you very much for coming and thank you for your prayers.
I'm Marnie's sister, Nora, and I've come out here to British Columbia several times, and Klaus was kind of my chauffeur in Lake Hog. I had some pretty scary times in the Beamer, but he always showed me around, and he'd point out all the places. He knew everything around the Okanagan. And the other thing about Klaus is I've been at home, I stay at home, and often in the daytime I would phone Marnie's house. I knew she was at work, but I knew I could talk to Klaus. And we'd talk about everything. I know he loved his kids so much. He loved Neil and David and Laura, and he just took Marnie's kids into his life too, and he loved them very much. And I'm going to miss him a lot. He was just a really special person, and I'm really grateful that you're all here today, and I know Klaus is here with us too. Anyway, that's all I have to say. I loved Klaus.
I would like to speak to Marnie for what her and Klaus became to my youngest son. His early father was less than perfect. None of us are perfect. But he was an abuser and an alcoholic. And when my son chose to come to this place and met Klaus and Marnie, they became like a parent figure, because my son always looked for an earthly father. There would be someone that he could love unconditionally, that would be loved, and that was Klaus and Marnie. And last Thursday night, not last Thursday, but the Thursday before, Klaus went to our Heavenly Father. My son and his wife and family spent the evening with Klaus and Marnie. And I am blessed to know that the thoughts that went through my son's heart when I told him about Klaus, he was hurting, he was broken in spirit. But he said to me that he's been a blessing to my family, Mom, and he will never be forgotten because he loved us so much. Thank you, Marnie. Thank you, Klaus. Bless you all.
Klaus and Marnie called last Halloween and asked if my daughter could babysit for them. And they said they would come to the door and pick her up. So I opened the door when the doorbell rang. And there was a little priest standing at the door. That was Marnie. And this very pregnant nun standing beside him. That was Klaus. And I just looked at them and I thought, you guys are so special. Like, they're really a very precious couple. And it's just a privilege that they've been a part of my life and my family's life. And Marnie, the Lord bless you and encourage you and comfort you.
Hi, my name is Peter. I'm Marnie's son, Klaus's stepson. When we were planning things this week, we were asking Laura, Klaus's daughter, what she wanted for today. And she said she wanted a happy celebration of life. And I think that's really happening, and there's been a lot of grief and a lot of tears, but it's so nice to smile and celebrate. And you know, I'm so happy that my mom met Klaus, because I had two average siblings before, and then I'm so grateful to have David, Neil, and Laura in our family. They're truly, you know, we don't share the same parents, but I consider them siblings, and we had a lot of really great memories together. We had a lot of fun growing up. As you've been hearing, Klaus wasn't the best driver. And I remember he was teaching Neil how to drive, which wasn't the best thing because Neil went through a stop sign and was T-boned everyone was okay, but the Oldsmobile that Klaus drove didn't do too well. But the good thing that came out of that, aside from Neil not being allowed to drive for some time, was we were allowed to open the door and hit anything when we were driving. And I remember being in Vancouver, and I don't know if it was with David or Neil, but we were about to go over the Lionsgate Bridge, and they were doing construction, and there was a bunch of orange pylons. And Klaus said, open the door! So we just whack, 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 whack. And just, that was Klaus. Just, I don't care, have fun, right? And I think we had our seatbelt on. I'm not sure. But we had a lot of great memories as a family, and I'm looking forward to continuing more. Last story I want to share. There's so many of them. This probably isn't appropriate for church, but whatever. As we've been hearing, Klaus had a lot of health problems, and about 15 years ago, he had a CM virus where he couldn't eat, he couldn't keep food down, food would go right through him, and he was actually down to about 113 pounds. I remember that time, us kind of mentally preparing for, you know, close to pass away, and I'd come home most days, and he'd be sitting in this lazy boy recliner because he couldn't move much, he couldn't work, couldn't do anything, and it was his appetite was the biggest thing. So we were discussing, the doctor said, we don't know what to do, and then I think it was my brother who suggested that perhaps marijuana makes people eat and get hungry, because I don't know anything about that, but Klaus talked to his doctor, and he said, is this an option? He said, you know what, at this point, there's really not much we can do. We don't know what to do. Try it. So we made some calls, and we got Klaus some weed, and he started smoking it. And everybody knows now, but most people knew, and It wasn't a bad thing. It was getting his appetite going. No other medication was working, and all of a sudden he started gaining weight. And unfortunately, due to the secondhand smoke, I think my mom did too. But one of my favorite things was, I came home from school one day, and a certain pastor of an old church, it definitely was not here, his car was in the driveway, and I thought, oh, look, so and so is here. I won't say who. And so I walked in, and it smelled like pot. And so I walk in, and Klaus is half asleep in the Lazy Boy, and Pastor so-and-so is asleep on the couch, and he gets up, oh, hey, Peter, and he runs out, and I'm like, what happened? I guess Klaus had just used his medication, and in the process, Pastor so-and-so walked in and maybe got high on the secondhand fumes and awkwardly fell asleep while watching TV with Klaus. And I said, Klaus, how many people can say that they got high with their pastor? And that's one of, again, I wanted to share a happy, fun memory, and I think that's what Klaus would have wanted, and it just shows how much he did fight, and he had went through a lot of things over the years, but, you know, without him, I certainly wouldn't be the person I am today, and I think that if there was more people like Klaus in the world, it would sure as heck be a way better place, and I'm going to miss him a lot.
Hi, my name's Andrew. I'm Marnie's son as well, and I'm the favorite son. And I, to be fair, I was not living at home, and I don't know anything about this marijuana story. It's the first I've heard of it. I do remember a couple that I won't tell all the other stories, but I actually just wanted to comment on family and what family is. And, you know, we see, to us and our, I know for my mom, this is our family. And again, to reiterate what my brother said, I mean, I got the younger brother I never had with Neil. Oh, sorry, Pete. And, you know, I never had a baby sister either, so, and, you know, like Peter said, we had some fun memories together, and I will also say with the Beamer, Klaus sort of taught me how to drive as well, and then, which is why I was never allowed to drive the Beamer, and, yesterday we were, Laura and Emerson and Peter, oh no, Peter didn't help, Petra and I, we were cleaning the Beamer, and I was thinking, you know, he would probably let me drive this car before he let me clean it, because he had so many cleaners and different things, and he really loved that car, and it was it's really nice to see it out there. But anyway, back to family, I just want to say that, you know, sometimes what brings us together is through marriage, and, you know, we wouldn't have met David, Neil, and Laura that way, and Klaus is the bridge for that, but, you know, that bridge isn't gone, and we still consider you family, and we always will, and I think it's just a testament for how many people are here, what Klaus did for us, and even for Petra and I, you know, he helped us with our business so many times, and he wasn't Klaus was a great cook, but he couldn't cook fries, I'll say that. And he did help us quite a bit, and you know, just any kind of handy thing that he could do, he'd always be trying to jump in there and let me try to fix that for you, let me do this. And again, I just wanted to say with family, we really appreciate everybody being here, and you know, tomorrow's my 6th anniversary, and Klaus, it's kind of a funny story, but my first date, real date with Petra, was my mom and Klaus's wedding. And anyway, I remember after the wedding, there was a little after party, and, you know, because I always called Klaus, and I remember Petra, this was, again, my first date, real date, and she says, comes up to my mom and Klaus after, and she says, I just can't call you Marnie and Klaus. I'm going to call you Mom and Dad, okay? Okay, you do that. And it was a little strange, and it worked out, obviously. 6 years, and tomorrow. And, you know, with Klaus, actually, Petra's dad couldn't be at our wedding, and Klaus stepped in and walked her down the aisle. So, anyway, that's just the kind of guy he was, and we love him. Thanks.
You get all the Verge girls today. I'm Marnie's sister, Jane, and I'm here with my husband, John, from California. And I've had the great fortune of arriving on a plane a few times as well and been greeted from everything from welcome Mrs. Dr. Jane Eddy to the Colonic Irrigation Festival and Showcase with complete with enema bags and what was the last one? Oh, what not to wear. So welcome. I was coming with my daughter. It was for 6 years ago for Andrew and Petra's wedding, and I subjected our poor youngest to what it was like with the BC cousins. And we arrived, and it was welcome Kathy and Jane Eddy to West Coast winners of what not to wear. We get off the plane looking totally normal. They have pants up to here and knee socks and everything else. And that's not the story I'm even going to tell. I'm going to tell a story about the last time Klaus and Marnie came to visit us, and we had some time together then. Actually, it did start with a convict dog, the bounty hunter, and Beth, but I won't go into that part of it. They arrived at my home. But we went to San Francisco. I took a couple of days off so we could have some time together. We went to San Francisco, and we... Marnie and Klaus had never been to Alcatraz, and they were going to go to Alcatraz. They were going to take this trip, and Nora and I had been, and we decided we were going to go to a museum, and we went into a museum, and we were looking around, and we came out, and all of a sudden we look over, and we go, Marnie, Klaus, and they said, oh, come over here, and there they were, and they had, and I don't know if you've been to San Francisco before, but there's a large population of homeless people in San Francisco, and at any given day, you can see many people on the street. And, you know, I appreciate, I think it was it Darcy who spoke earlier and said to say hello and to make contact and to validate who they are. And you know, that's all about who Klaus and Marnie were. And it was beautiful. They said, come and meet our friends. And they had collected many people, and they were all sitting at two picnic tables, and they didn't go to Alcatraz. They took their money and they bought everybody something to eat. And you know, I went to a funeral a couple years ago, and everybody who got up talked about this gentleman and talked about how he made a difference in their life. And I think that's what I want to say about my brother-in-law, Klaus. What they said about this gentleman, and what I will tell you about Klaus, is that he lived his life with intent. Never a day went by. You didn't have a casual conversation with Klaus. He was always eyes outward, looking to see how he could help and make a difference for people. And I look at what he started and what all of us can carry on in his name, and I am grateful. I'm grateful that my crazy sister met him and brought him into our family. I'm grateful for the children that we got, and in particular Laura. My girls got to spend some time. They learned to be crazy and dress up with Laura. And I, you know, it's been a wonderful time, and I value him, and I love him, and I'm going to miss him. And most of all, I'm just incredibly grateful for having him in my life.
Hi, I'm Susan. I'm Klaus's stepdaughter. I'm trying to think. There's so many memories, and I just don't even know where to start, and I'm trying not to cry. But Peter and Angie had a lease. And sorry, I'm going to... Everybody take a breath with me. Okay. We went on a road trip. We decided to go on this road trip and just go see Elise. She was just born, and I went along with my mom and Klaus, and my mom was not a good passenger, and especially with Klaus driving really fast. And on the way there was an accident on the Coca-Cola, and everybody was, I don't know, these crazy people were turning around and trying to come back on the one way at us, and my mom rolls the window down and starts having this sing-song, and Klaus is singing along, and it was just a crazy ride there. Mom's like, I'm not a good passenger, and... So, I don't know, I think she might have taken something for it, but anyway, it doesn't matter. Klaus is driving, and all of a sudden, his eye got bloodshot, and he couldn't drive, so then I'm driving. And anyway, we made it to Vancouver, And we picked up Laura. And it was crazy. Laura and I decided that we were going to go into this grocery store. And you had to get some groceries. And we all went into Save-On. And Laura and I are just grabbing groceries. And we come out into the parking garage after. And we're telling Klaus, be careful. There's like this barrier, this wall there. Oh no, I can take it. I can turn my car. It'll be fine. So he takes the truck, and all of a sudden you just hear this scraping, and it just cracked the car. And he's like, oh man. And there was other words, but anyway, him and my mom, like, she's like, oh no, Klaus. Like, the whole truck was just scratched. And I'll never forget, Laura looks in the back and she goes, hey, the bread's not squished. And Klaus laughed so hard, like everything was completely okay after Laura said that. We all just burst out laughing, even though this truck has this big scratch in it. We just continued on, and he went to go see Peter and Ange and Elise, and we just had a really good time. And I won't forget that weekend, because I spent that day with Laura, and Laura and I just really bonded as stepsisters. And I just really consider you your big sister, and I just love you, and I loved your dad. Klaus really loved my daughter. He taught her how to ride a bike with my mom. And I'm just really going to miss him, and I know Sayla is too. And I'm so thankful, because at Christmas they made a book just the night before Christmas, and they took turns reading it, so I'll always have his voice. And we're making a copy for Elise too, and it's just so nice to have. But anyway, I'm really going to miss him. He was awesome. He was such a good grandfather to Sayla. That's it.
So many pictures just to paint so many words to paint a beautiful picture of who Klaus was. And he is going to be missed. At this point, we're just going to show us a slideshow of Klaus's life.
I gotta hear it. I don't have the together we were fooled into the mistake. Come on.
you all stand? We just have two more songs to sing. This was a favorite of Klaus, just a partial song here. Healing rain is falling down. Healing rain is falling down. My name no more.
Father, we just thank you this morning, God. Lord, we thank you for your peace and your comfort. We thank you for the hope that we have in you, God. Lord, that you will never leave us or forsake us. Father, we can have confidence this morning, God. Lord, as we come and just surrender to you, that you will touch us, that you will heal us, and that you will love us. Father, we pray for Marnie and the children, God, that there would just be such a sense of your peace and love over these next few days and weeks and months, God, as they transition in their life, that they would just really sense that you are near to them, God. Lord, that you will walk beside them, God, that you will carry them. Lord, help us as their friends and family just to reach out. God, give us the words of comfort and the wisdom to know when to speak, God. Lord, to be your arms around them, God, your voice, your love. Lord, we thank you that Klaus this morning is more alive than he's ever been. God, that he's with you, Father. He's with you and the angels, God. And we thank you, God, that we can experience that for ourselves in those moments when we just come and surrender and say, Jesus, just have your way in us. Have your way in our hearts. I thank you, Lord, that there was a moment in Klaus's life when he made that commitment to you. And he surrendered and he said, Lord, you are my God. Holy Spirit, I just ask that you would just draw everyone here into that relationship of love with you that you so desire to carry, to give. We thank you, Lord. We bless your holy name.